Oh, right. Thank you for coming. We're going to spend, as Steve has said, we're going to spend about 40 to 45 minutes just looking at the subject of digital. And I want to begin by asking probably the most fundamental of questions, but it's the kind of question that really kind of needs answering before we go any further. And that question is, what is digital? Because I think there's a lot of confusion about that and what that means today and what this thing digital is and how it kind of fits into our world. And we hear all these phrases thrown around, don't we? Digital transformation. We need a digital strategy. We've got a digital team. And there's often a little bit of vagueness about what that actually means in real terms. And so that's what I want to kind of just start by looking at. Well, one argument is that digital is a combination of a set of technologies. Things like the web, email, social media, and mobile. You could go even broader, I guess, and include any technology of any description. But then it becomes a little bit meaningless, really, when you go that broad. But one argument is that it's about these four key technologies. And we do live at quite an interesting time where all of these have really come to maturity in just the last few years, really. Yeah, sure, they've been around for donkey's years, but our behavior and our attitudes towards them are changing, especially with social and mobile. But actually, I don't think at the heart of it, that is what digital is really about. And it's certainly not what it's about for you as an institution. It's much more profound than that. You see, I think digital is something more than just technology. And the reason I think that is because we've seen that in the past, okay? Take, for example, the Industrial Revolution, the automobile, and the printing press. Three great examples of technology. But each of those examples haven't just been, oh, a new piece of technology. Instead, they've been things that have fundamentally altered the world we live in, haven't they? If you take, for example, the arrival of the printing press. Before the arrival of the printing press, literacy was at an incredibly low level. But more importantly, the arrival of the printing press changed the balance of power. Before the arrival of the printing press, the Catholic Church defined doctrine because the vast majority of people couldn't read scripture. When the printing press came along, suddenly the Bible was in the hands of everybody. It empowered the Protestant movement that changed the shape of the world we live in. Then along came the Industrial Revolution, the idea of a factory line. It's just a piece of technology, isn't it? But the factory line fundamentally changed the world in which we lived. We went from being a society of rural subsistence farmers, and suddenly populations moved. They moved from the countryside into the cities. So that changed our behaviours. It changed our relationship with our families, with our peers. It changed how we, our economy. It had profound impacts on our society, but it was just a piece of technology. And then the automobile came along. And after all suddenly going into the cities for employment, now you could commute. So the suburbs were born because of a piece of technology. Our transportation infrastructure changed. There were profound changes in society. So what I'm kind of over-laboring here is that technology has a much bigger impact on society and our behavior and our personalities and who we are than we might like to think. That we have a symbiotic relationship with technology. We create technology, but technology creates us and who we are. And digital is another prime example of that. So digital is beginning to have fundamental impacts on our behavior and our lives. Digital has changed how students behave, how we all behave. Now, it's interesting. I'm going to try an experiment here, and it will tell me a lot about you as an audience. Think about you're lying in bed first thing in the morning, right? Just kind of the alarm's just gone off, you've turned off the alarm, and you're just lying there a little bit dozy. What's the first thing you now do? Do you reach up and pick up your smartphone? Raise your hands if you do that. Yeah. Technology has changed our lives. It's changed who we are. The first thing we do from the moment we wake up is connect with digital technology. We check our email. We go on Facebook. We engage on Twitter. And no offense to you guys in this audience, but you're like me, old, right? We're of either the baby boomer generation or of Generation X, okay? We didn't grow up with digital. We've adopted digital into our lives, okay? Now imagine for a moment, if we're like that, imagine how much more the students of today are like that. How they live and breathe digital and digital technology in everything we do. Millennials are essentially digital natives. All of their formative years have been spent with digital, and they see the world in a radically different way than we do. And we need to adapt to that. For a start, they see themselves as consumers and not as students anymore. There has been a change in their perceptions because of what they've learned through technology. What they've learned through the web. They have unprecedented access to choice that's made them consumers rather than passive students. They've come to expect an outstanding quality of digital deliverable. They don't understand why they pay you thousands of pounds per year in tuition fees, and yet they receive inferior services in digital compared to what they get free from Google or Facebook. How does that work? In their minds, it doesn't. Now, we know that Google and Facebook are mining their data and they are paying for it, but that's how they perceive things. So that really shifts things. If they see themselves as consumers and not as students, it changes the balance of things. It moves us into a more customer service mentality. They expect good customer service from a university. That's quite scary, isn't it? Because that's not what we signed up to. That's not how we perceive things, but it is how this generation perceive things. Because they get good customer service from other organisations, so why not you? If they tweet, as I did yesterday, moaning about the time I was delayed sitting on the tarmac and had a go at Flybe, and within 10 minutes, I got a reply from Flybe. Yet, do I get the same from a university? If I ask a question on social media, will I get a reply? Will I get a reply in the evenings? What about weekends? What about if I'm a student, on a Friday evening I go out and get abused while on university property? And I tweet about that. While you're all sitting at home over the weekend, a big PR disaster blows up. Because the world is now 24/7 and universities are having to adapt to the fact that your audience now has the power, that they can share things continually, that they are online continually and they expect you to be online too. If they don't get the level of service that they've come to expect, they will complain. And they will complain in no uncertain terms because they know they have the power. It used to be that you as an institution had the power, right? You could push out your message through press releases, through marketing and promotion and in comms. And the power lay with you. All I could do as a student is maybe complain to one or two friends. Now I have the world to complain to. I have an audience. I have a voice. I can go along to ratemytutor.com. I can post on Facebook. I can post on Twitter. Here's a great example. Not from higher education, but it kind of shows the problem. That his father, British Airways, lost his father's luggage, right? And he had to deal with this because his father was elderly and couldn't deal with it. So it fell to the son to deal with. And the son contacted customer services at British Airways, and he got pushed from pillar to post. And in the end, he complained on Twitter. And he heard nothing back from British Airways at all. So over a weekend, he decided, this was on a Friday evening, decided to take out a promoted tweet where he pays a small amount of money, and every time somebody tweets on British Airways, they get a message saying, don't fly with British Airways, they suck, right? Friday evening, British Airways weren't checking social media, they weren't committed to supporting digital. Nobody knew. Saturday morning, the tech blogs, right, picked up on this. They thought it was funny and a nice filler for the weekend. So they picked it up and they ran it. Saturday evening, mainstream media that needed to pad their listings, schedule for Sunday, they picked it up. It was on BBC News before Monday morning when the British Airways staff got back in the office. One person. You're one person away from a PR disaster because the power now lives with your students and not with you. The world has changed. They want to interact online. This is how they want to interact with you. They don't want to be picking up the phone. They don't want to be talking to people. They want fast self-service. And they really hate forms and bits of paper that you require them to fill in. Why can't I do it digitally? Do you know what's just happening at the moment? There's a bit of paper being handed around where you're going to write down your email address if you want to kind of keep up on what's happening in digital in the institution, right? I said before we came into this meeting, you get an iPad app and people can just fill it in straight in there. Oh, no, we do it with paper, right? It's fine with you lot, but if you were a student, that would be very unacceptable. What a waste of time. I mean, you look around lecture halls these days, right? It's just walls of MacBooks, isn't it? As far as the eye can see. Can't see students' faces anymore. You're lecturing to MacBooks. And that's the world we live in, and that's what they want. Now, but whether you agree or disagree with that, that's what they want. That's what they expect. That's what we need to be delivering. You see, and this is a generation that thinks in a fundamentally different way, right? So, for example, I'm a student. I'm a struggling poor student. They never have enough money, do they, bless them? And they have this hard life and they're struggling through, and they can't feed themselves and they don't have enough money to go out to the pub and they certainly don't have money to buy decent clothes. But for some reason they have money to sign up for Netflix and they have money to buy a new hat for their avatar in their favourite game. Right? It's insanity, isn't it, from our perspective? But from theirs, they value digital as much as they value physical. Now, let's follow that logic through. Let's say, if students really do value the digital as much as the physical, in the last year, how much has St. Andrews spent on physical assets, on things like buildings, or facilities, or computer labs, or whatever? And how much is it spending on digital? The relationship will have, there will just be poles about. In fact, if digital had 1% of what you spend on physical, then you'd have a massive digital team doing really cool things. There's a huge imbalance between us as pre-digital people in our mindsets and how we look at the world, and how senior management see the world. What's the value in pixels? But there's value in bricks and mortar and physical things. But that's not how the new generation sees things. It's not how they look at the world. So in all of this, what are we talking about here? Well, we're saying that digital is really about people. It's about, ultimately, digital is about people and not technology. It's about better serving connected consumers. It's accepting that student behaviour has changed and that we need to adapt to it. So actually, it's not about technology for technology's sake. It's not about, oh, what new CRM are we going to put in place, or what or I hate our content management system. It's none of that. It's about better serving connected consumers, connected students, and the way that they see things. Now, the trouble is that's quite hard for us to adjust to. Because when anything new comes along, like me, right? Most of it's first time you've met me, right? And each of you are now categorising me, right? We won't get into how you're categorising me. I'll leave that. You can keep that thought in your head. But suffice it to say, you're categorising me either as an extrovert or an idiot or whatever, right? And that's how we work as human beings, and that works very well. That's how we adapt quickly to new situations. And that's exactly what we've done with digital. Digital came along and we went, oh, that's to do with computers. So it must be an IT thing. We'll put it in the IT department. And then after a while, we were like, oh, well, people seem to be looking at this. It's kind of comms tool, isn't it, really? We call it comms now. It's now comms. But the problem is that digital is such a profound change. It's so enormous that it breaks our existing mental models, how we normally see the world. It doesn't fit nicely into the business silos that we have as institutions. It actually is more than a marketing tool or a comms tool or an IT tool. It's something that has a profound effect on every part of our organisation. And we know that. The fact that digital becomes so controversial every time you want to make a change to the website is an indication of how important it is to everybody. Yet what do we try and do? We try and cram it into our existing mental models, and we don't allow it to change us as an institution. It's changed your users, yet we're still structured how we were 50 years ago, 100 years ago. We need to adapt to the new world, the new digital reality that we live in. We cannot bolt on digital to the side of our organisations. Basically, there is no business as usual anymore. The way we've always done things as an institution will not continue to work and will begin to undermine us. What worked in the past will not work anymore. All of our preconceptions need to be considered, and we need to start thinking digitally by default. What do I mean by that? Well, being digital by default is not saying you should always use digital, okay? That digital is the answer to everything. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's totally inappropriate. But you need to challenge the ways that you do things in your jobs, right? Think about what you do in your job right now. All of those things you do instinctively day by day, right? So let's say you work in comms, right? Oh, we've made a new big discovery in some area of research. We need to promote it. Oh, right, what do I always do in these scenarios? Oh, I always do a press release, right? And we kind of just fall into habits, don't we, of ways of working. Digital by default says, okay, well, before I fall into the way of working that I always work, let's ask whether digital could help in this situation to solve this. Whether there is some way that digital can help us. Now, we might not always know the answer to that and might need to speak to digital experts, and that's fine. But like in a scenario like that, then maybe, instead of sending out a press release, what normally happens is we write a press release, send it to the press release, and then we bung it on the website. Well, hang on a minute, a press release is written for the press, and the website is written for everybody. So there's a difference there. So perhaps what we should be doing instead is going, okay, well, actually, this is really interesting. We think this could go viral. This bit of research is really quite interesting. So let's create a little video promoting it and put that on YouTube and then share it with social networks. And then, okay, we need to do a press release as well, but let's do this first, see if this is effective, because that may be the way that it gets picked up and gets picked up by the mainstream media. So it's a question of just challenging the way we think about things. We can't just always do the same things that we've always done and hope that they work. That failure to adapt to the new reality is slowly killing us as organisations. It's undermining our credibility in the eyes of the new generation. And that is causing a problem. It's changing education as well in quite profound ways. Things like distance learning, MOOCs. Actually, there's a growing number of non-university alternatives for education now that just bypass the traditional education system entirely. Does that leave St. Andrews in danger of being irrelevant in the future? Now, not today, of course not. You've got an amazing international reputation. You're not in any danger. But a lot of other people thought that. Do you know, an analyst report in the late 90s from Blockbusters said technology poses no danger to the future of Blockbusters. And then Netflix came along. You cannot take your current position for granted. 5-10 years down the line, things can change very quickly. Harvard, get this. Lawrence Summers from Harvard wrote, the solid classical buildings of great universities may look permanent, but the storm of change now threatens to them. There are fundamental changes going on, and there is significant danger that some large institutions will be closing their doors in the next 10 years or so. That is the reality that we're in. Why would I pay thousands of pounds to come here when there are other opportunities? Opportunities that allow me to get my education wherever, whenever, however I like. Now, you're all thinking of the benefits, but you're not the same generation. Things are changing, and we need to be aware of that. And to make matters worse, most universities are about as digitally incompatible as you could possibly get. They're decentralized, they're slow moving, they're unfocused, and they have many levels of management to them. And that means that they've got all kinds of problems. And that made sense. I'm not actually criticizing that approach, right? In actual fact, it made a lot of sense. Let's say, for example, let's go back 100 years. And the university wants to build a new state-of-the-art facility, right? Now, in that kind of situation, the cost of failure is really high, isn't it? If you build a dodgy building, it'll fall down and kill people, and that would be bad, right? Or, you know, there are all kinds of cost of building something like that is astronomical. You have to get it right first time. So what do? You have a standard operating procedure. You have a procurement process. You have a committee that reviews the work that's being done. You have all of these checks and balances in place to prevent problems. Very sensible. But what happens when the barrier to entry is really low? What happens when you're talking about digital and you can put something online, find out it doesn't work and correct it in half an hour? What about a situation where you're running maybe 50 to 100 A-B tests at any one time on your website to see which approach performs better? Do you really want to go through a committee for every single one of those? Do you need that kind of check and balance when the price of failure is so low, or is a different way of working necessary? So we need to change our cultures and our thinking. One of the biggest ways we need to change our thinking is in terms of projects. We think of everything in terms of projects, don't we, as a university, right? And building a building 100 years ago is a project. You start it, you build it, you're done. Okay, you've got a bit of maintenance, but that's it. And people approach digital in the same way. Well, we're going to have a planning phase that'll go to an approval committee, then we'll build whatever it is we're going to build, then we'll be done and there'll be a little bit of maintenance. But you know what? Digital isn't like that. Digital, when you're building digital assets, you're constantly having a dialogue and a back and forth with users, right? You're learning. It's almost like a scientific process or an academic process. You form a hypothesis, you build a test case, you test it, refine your hypothesis and test it again in this continual cycle of refining and improving, right? We don't say about the theory of evolution or string theory or anything else, oh, they're done, right? They're untouchable. We can never challenge them or never look at them again. They are set in stone. No, they're constantly open to peer review and changing and adapting and updating. And that's where we need to be at Digital. I'd describe as Digital is more like a garden than it is a building. It needs tending and pruning and improving. And the longer you look after it, the better it becomes. So we need to break that kind of thinking, because the project thinking is devastating. Lots of our organizations have tried to treat digital as projects with a beginning, a middle, and an end, right? And the consequences of that are devastating. Birmingham City Council, probably can't see that on the screen, but Birmingham City Council spent £2.5 million on redesigning their website. £2 million over budget. Because they treated it as a project, a big, mahoosif project that got bogged down in all kinds of stuff. Department of Trade and Industry, this was a good one. Every time you visit you visited the Department of Trade and Industry website, it cost the government £11.78 per visit. Well, I found that out. I went along to the website, click, refresh, 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 refresh. And then, of course, I realised I was a taxpayer and actually I was paying that money. Right? Obscene way of doing digital. Frugo, that was an e-commerce site, spent €40 million on getting their e-commerce right, right? Mailing the most incredible platform in the world. They were going to dominate e-commerce, challenge Amazon. They made €100,000 in revenue because they didn't test or try anything. They just went for it. This is our big vision. Let's do it. Our big project. And then there's Boo.com, Boo.com, I just put in there for comedy value, because they spent $135 million in 18 months. I would challenge you to try and do that. I think that is a real achievement. I think, really, that isn't a failure. I think that is a success. Anyone that can spend that amount of money in that length of time is okay by me. And then the most recent example is healthcare.gov. Healthcare.gov have currently spent $319 million on their website, and that's set to rise to $677 million. Do you know what happened as a result of this? It was the first time the leader of the free world had to apologize for a website. I think that's a real turning point in our world. But better still, they realized the error of their ways, and actually they've set up a totally different way of working now, which doesn't rely on these big projects. So there are lots of really big failures. So this is all well and good. I've been very critical, and I've pointed out a lot of holes. So how do we improve things? How do we go about making things better? And that's where this phrase digital transformation comes in. It's a phrase that's been thrown around a lot. And it's a phrase that a lot of large organizations are taking very seriously. Organisations like Starbucks, Disney, General Electric, the British government, the European Commission, Dell, and McDonald's. But they're all, you know, they're not you. But University of Surrey, University of Bath, University of Strathclyde, University of Belfast, UCL, Harvard, and UCAS are all undertaking major restructuring of the way their organizations work to better serve connected consumers. Digital is no longer a little service department that sits in IT somewhere. It's something much more profound that's shaping the entire future and shape of their organization. And it starts with restructuring how we see digital and putting customers and students at the heart of what we do. And all of that begins with a new focus. The problem is that digital has a lot of woolly thinking around it. Because the people making the big decisions, senior management, heads of departments and schools, none of us are digital natives. We don't really understand digital properly. So we end up setting woolly objectives of stuff that we kind of like to maybe see. But what we need is clear objectives for digital, a clear strategy for transforming and changing our organizations. Not just goals, but practical steps for achieving those goals. Ones that recognize the institutional barriers that will be encountered and how to challenge and overcome those barriers. We also need to get to know our users much more, to understand how students really think and really behave. Earlier, I made jokes, didn't I, about students stereotypical student's behavior in terms of not having enough food and all those kinds of things. And that's the trouble, we get stuck in our head, these kind of stereotypical images of students that are very out of date and probably not very accurate. And we need to embed user thinking in the heart of our mentality. As you walk around this university, I always notice, whenever I go into any organizations, I notice what they have on their walls, right? Universities are the worst for this. They have big buildings being opened by important people, or, you know, profound thinking portraits of some major academic or awards won. It's all you. It's all about you. Now, you go into a company, a startup company like MailChimp, that is digitally aware and digitally savvy and operates in that kind of arena, do you know what they have on their walls? Their customers. Pictures of their customers, as far as you can see them. Very different mentality, very different way of thinking about things. We need to start mapping and understanding our customer journeys, how students pass through the institution. And I know I keep using the word customer, and I know it probably grates on some of you, but that's the reality. That's how students see themselves. We need to talk to the people that are day-to-day operating and working with students, rather than senior management making decisions in isolation. And we need to bake customer service into the organizational DNA that we have. And that means, in order to achieve all this, we need strong, empowered digital leadership. Most organizations that are undertaking digital transformation are even adding chief digital officers to their C-suite, to the very top of the organization. How does that contrast with your average university? They're probably three or four levels down, buried in some IT department or comms department somewhere. Very different mentality. They're managed by committees. There's a real problem with committees, is that committees, you're getting everybody together in a committee, could happen once a month maybe, if you're lucky, get everybody's schedule. We're needing to make decisions about digital daily. Booking.com are making over 100 updates to their website every day. Also, the other problem with committees is you get the wrong people are making the decisions. You get everybody together sitting in a room making it, talking about this stuff, and you've got, like, you end up with the head of IT making comments about the colour. There's no overall authority. There needs to be one person that is committed to changing the direction of the organisation and an executive sponsor to oversee them. A strong digital lead that implements a strategy that has the authority to make decisions and maintain the momentum of the organisation. And an executive sponsor that has got the political clout within the organisation to protect that team. That this team, led by our digital lead, will champion the cause of the connected consumer. And they will oversee what I call a digital transformation team. Now, different organisations call it different things, but I call it digital transformation team for a couple of reasons. First of all, I use the word digital. Notice the word digital there and not web. Digital, you know, social media, email marketing, the website, mobile, all of these things are very interconnected, right? That a user moves seamlessly backwards and forwards between these different platforms, okay? But in most institutions, they're fragmented across the organization. So they get inconsistencies. I remember once when I bought an iPad and I couldn't get it on the network with Three. And I went to the Three website and there was nothing about the problem. I called them up and I was on hold for a best part of an hour because the iPad had just come out. They had no answer either. They couldn't fix it. But they referred me back to the website. Okay. In the end, I got so frustrated, I posted on social media how shit I thought Three were. And their social media team got in contact very quickly, actually. I was impressed. I told them the problem. They said, oh, yeah, that's this. Just do this, this, and this, and it'll fix it. There was no joined upness. Well, somebody in the organization knew the problem and how to fix it. Why wasn't that on the website? Why wasn't the call center people knowing about that? I was having a fragmented experience because it was so spread across the organization. So that's why I talk about digital rather than web. In terms of transformation, I use this for two reasons. One is I'm not talking about a service department. This is not a team that you go to and you say, I want to build this. Build it for me. Make it happen. This is a team that leads the direction of digital, that works with you to find the best digital solution, that comes to you when they're at the point of addressing your area of expertise, and you join them and work alongside them in a collaborative relationship. So they're not a service department. Now, you might be getting worried at this point, because what we're talking about here is we're talking about creating a centralized team that is not beholden to your desires for the website, but instead are leading the digital direction. Have we not just created another business silo, another problem? And that's another reason why I use the word transformation. Baked into the mandate of this team is the fact their ultimate goal is to transform the institution in regards to digital. Back in the Industrial Revolution, when electricity first came along, no organisation really knew what to do with it. They knew it was important, but they weren't quite sure what to do with it. So they appointed chief electricity officers. So when you went into work, you'd ask the chief electricity, well, what am I supposed to do with this electricity thing then? Sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? That you would have to go to someone, can I use some electricity, please? But actually, at the time, it made a lot of sense because people didn't really get or understand electricity. We don't have chief electricity officers today, do we? Because electricity is baked in to everything we do. It's ubiquitous, isn't it? It's a part of every, from the moment, if we have a power cut now, that would be the end of this presentation, wouldn't it? That would be it, we'd just give up. The fact that you could probably still hear me without it is beside the point. We would just give up. Our lives stop without electricity. Do you know what? That's where we are aiming to get to with digital. That every single one of you will be using digital every day in part of everything you do. That you will be engaging with people via social media, via email marketing, via mobile, via the website. All of these tools will be at your fingertips. But in order to get to that place, we need to know how to use those tools to the best ability. We need new standard operating procedures, new ways of working. So baked in, so the digital transformation team is the modern equivalent of a chief electricity officer. They won't exist in 5-10 years' time. Maybe 10 years. Five might be a bit ambitious for a university anyway. Eventually, the power, the responsibility, the ownership will go back to everybody else over time as they're better equipped to deal with these things. So when I talk about a digital transformation team, I'm talking about a team that has got a centralized content team to work with you guys to ensure quality content is being delivered online. Content that is consistent with the university's overall brands and objectives, but also meets your specific needs within your various business units. That you won't have to pore over creating and writing all the content yourself. There'll be a team of professionals to help you do that, as well as designers, developers, and all of those other things that you would expect. Interestingly, you might think, well, this is quite a big team we're talking about here. And yeah, it is. But do you know what? In most institutions, the people are already there. They're just fragmented, spread out across the institution, not talking to one another, all reporting into different people. And nothing is coherently managed. You're reinventing the wheel the whole time. And all it involves is bringing those people together. Even if not permanently, you know, put them on secondment, do it however you want. But those people need to start talking and working together. But all of this needs to have a clear focus on championing the needs of connected students. And that needs to be the basis. But this digital transformation team also needs a startup culture. It needs to work in a very different way than universities traditionally work. It needs to work with through experimentation, testing, iteration, prototyping, trying stuff out, seeing what works and doesn't. An environment where it's acceptable to fail because the cost of failure is low. You're not talking about multi-million pound projects. They need to work through in an agile sprint methodology. In other words, they need to be quickly moving through development without reams of documentation or approval beforehand. That prototyping, creating something tangible, becomes your specification of what you're creating. Projects will move much faster. They'll be much more user-orientated if they're tested and iterated in this way. But that means that they need to be unencumbered by large institutional thinking. And they need to be protected from that in order to operate and move fast. Do I work with one university that will remain nameless? And I made some suggestions about how they would restructure things a little bit. And there was one guy in the room, a developer in the room, that was so fed up. In fact, the whole team was, but he in particular was so fed up, so demoralized that he couldn't get stuff done, that he'd had time off of work sick, that he'd been unproductive, and he'd just given up. He was just phoning it in. And I felt so sorry for him, and we made some suggestions about how things could be restructured and reorganized, and some better ways of working. And then I happened to run into him at a conference, and it was really awkward, actually, because I was standing chatting with a potential client at this conference. I was, you know, doing the kind of schmoozing thing, you know, oh, yes, I'm so talented, etc. And talking about it, and I saw him making a beeline for me across the room, and he looked like he had thunder. You know, he was looking really determined. I thought, shit, what have I done? What's he going to say in front of this client? He came stomping over to me, and he said, "You made me cry." And it was like, what? What have I done? But he went on to explain how that had opened up new freedom for them, that they'd been able to do the job that they were paid to do because we'd restructured and reorganized the way they operate and the way that they see things. And that's not just a one-off occasion. I've come across that time and time again. People that have stepped up to the challenge and been able to do incredible things once we get out of their way, once we get the institutional culture out of their way. Right, I'm going on a little bit long. So one thing I wanted to talk about is how development works and the difference between digital and traditional. Let's say we're building a car, right? Now, I'm going to show my ignorance about building cars here. Right, you start with an individual component, right? A wheel, okay? Now, when you build that wheel, it's useless. It's just a wheel. It gives no value to the car manufacturer. It gives no value to you as a university. It gives no value to the consumer. Consumer hasn't even seen it, right? It's just a wheel. And then what we do is we go and, you know, we start putting the components together, don't we, over time, and you kind of start assembling your car, but you know, still no value. It's a big investment by the car manufacturer to build this car. The users still haven't seen it. The drivers haven't seen it. So, well, they like the car. What will Top Gear say about our car, right? All of that kind of stuff is unknown. So there's a big risk involved. And then eventually you finish your car, and then it's make or break moment, right? Ta-da to the world. Have you built the right car? Is it going to go down well? Has it gone over budget? All of those things hang on that linchpin moment. And that's how the Birmingham City Council built their website. That's how the trading industry people built their website. That's how boo.com built their website. But there is another way. This is the way that you guys should be operating with digital. You don't build a car, you build a skateboard. The most basic version of a car there is, right? Two wheels and a board. And then you put it out there and you say, "Dear user, do you like our skateboard?" And they'll go, "Yeah, I quite like that. But you know what? You know, your skateboard would be so much better if it had a handle." So you go back and you build a handle on it. Ooh, scooter. Got a new thing now. Bit better? Go back to the consumers again. Go back to users and say, "What do you think? Do you like our scooter? What do you reckon of that?" "Well, yeah, it's really good, but my legs get tired. It'd be good if I could sit down on something. All right, well, we'll go away. And we go away again and we evolve it further. We improve it further. We tweak and refine it further. And then you end up with a bike. Right? Ta-da, here's our bike. What do you think of our bike? Now, it might be at this point that everybody goes, yeah, I love their bike. So we stop there. Because why invest more money in building a car if all people want is a bike? Right? That's why you've got six figures in terms of the number of web pages on your site. Because you didn't just stop at a bike. You kept adding and you're adding and adding and adding, wasting time and money on building something people don't want. You should have stopped at a bike. But, you know, sometimes they don't go, I'm getting really lazy. Sitting down was great, but this whole peddling business, so you add to the site again, and you build yourself a motorbike. And then people might say, well, I want to take passengers with me. And then you end up at the car. But right from stage one, you've got something viable, something to go out there, something for the world to use and to try and experiment with. You're providing value to the institution and the user from day one, not all the way down here. And at every step of the way, you're giving them more value. Every step of the way, you've got a reason to go back to your users and say, look at the great things we've got now. Look how we're moving forward. Look how things are getting better. Isn't that a better way of working? And alongside that, we need to be building a framework. A framework that informs our decision-making approaches. Put in place new policies and procedures. Things like, how are we going to deal with someone that complains about the website because they're blind and they can't read the text? Things like, what are we going to do if a student accuses a lecturer of groping with them on social media? Things like, I want my content on the homepage and you're telling me I can't have it. Why? How do you make that decision? So there are all these kind of governance issues that go around it as well. But everything we do needs to be a collaborative approach. That this isn't something that some little team goes away in a corner and does, but does something by bringing in experts. So if he's working on alumni content, someone from alumni needs to come in and be involved, to be participating and involved in that process. Because it educates the digital transformation team about alumni and their needs, but it also educates the alumni person about the potential of digital, so they can go back and be confident in the final results. Our aim, remember, is to make digital ubiquitous across the whole organization. But we are right now in an awkward transition period. Digital has become business critical, but we, as the people that run the institution, are not digital natives. Give this another 10, 15 years, everyone sitting in this room will have grown up with digital. They will be completely comfortable and familiar with it. But right now, we've got a problem. That the demand for quality digital products from our audience is not something we naturally can deliver. And we need to put processes in place to do that. And that can only happen if we work collaboratively with digital experts and educate ourselves through the process. For me, it's all summed up. The reason I call my book Digital Adaptation when I wrote about these kinds of issues is because of a quote from Darwin, when he said, it's not the strongest of a species that survived, nor the most intelligent that survives. It's the ones that are most adaptable to change. I don't care how good the reputation of St. Andrews is. I don't care how well respected you are, how intelligent you are, that you're the strongest and the most intelligent of your species out there. If you do not adapt to change, you will not survive. I know this is quite a tough message I've shared with you, and I've shaken quite a few of the kind of ways that universities operate. If it's any consolation, you are not alone. This is something the whole sector is struggling with. But you need to act now, because the window of opportunity is closing. Other institutions are getting a head start on you. And there is a great digital team here, but they need bigger buy-in from across the organization. We need to be getting to the point where digital is starting to become ubiquitous, and we need a management team that is going to support the changes that need to happen.